And we're back live with the Humble Prince on Saharatv FM Radio. Thank you guys for tuning in. Big shout out to everybody in the UK, man. We're already calling and everything. Big shout out to everybody in Nigeria, too. And of course, our American listeners. Big shout out to her. And of course, we have a celebrity in the house. I'd like to thank him, Lula. Yeah.
Besides Humble Prince?
Yeah. Oh, Shakira. Nice mouse with the kissing up, man. It's working. Yeah. Taking pictures and everything. We have actor, producer, writer, everything, Mr. Gbenga Akinnagbe in the house. Thank you.
Gbenga, what's up, guys? Thanks for having me.
No, thank you so much for coming. Gbenga, please pronounce your last name pronounce me, because Shakira's been messing it up.
Now you can hear me mess it up.
Yeah.
Akinnagbe.
Akinnagbe. Okay, yeah. I said I was keep saying Akinnagbe. Pronounce it.
Akinnagbe.
Hey.
Fantastic, man.
I try, oh.
Thanks for joining us, man.
Thanks for having me.
Gbenga of Law & Order, most recently Graceland. But I think what everybody knows you for is the renowned and critically acclaimed award-winning HBO hit series, The Wire, man.
Yes,
yeah, that was a big shout out to DJ Wally, man. DJ Wally's listening to him. That's his favorite show, man. Our DJ.
He couldn't make it tonight.
Yeah, yeah. Great show. And, you know, I won't lie, man. That was one of my favorite shows, too. But I think there was one or two I put, you know, maybe side by side. But yeah, tell it. Thanks for joining us, man. How's everything?
Thanks, man. Things are good. Things are very well.
So I know you had some good news you wanted to share. You want to just share that first? Because everybody knows about The Wire. And go Google him. He's all over YouTube, man. That's right. Yeah. But let's talk about what's coming up.
I'm heading out to London to start shooting the new season, the new miniseries of 24.
Ooh, nice.
That's huge, man. Thanks for making that announcement on the show.
I'm very excited.
24 is one of my favorite series of all time, man. You're going to have a ball, man. Now, please tell me, man, because one of the problems I had, man, anytime they had like a African dude, it was always a villain. Please tell me you're not a villain.
I'm not only not a villain, but I'm not African. So
fantastic. All right, good, man. That's fantastic, man. So what how did you get into that? Talk about a little bit.
As far as like what?
Get into 24, yeah.
Oh, I auditioned. They dug me. They offered me the role.
Oh, fantastic, man. That's
I was
good,
fortunate.
Man.
I was very fortunate. I mean I didn't go into it thinking I had never watched 24, so
really?
I knew it was a big show. I knew it had like it had a great deal of social influence and even political influence because of they're talking about it in Congress and with these because of soldiers who were emulating things that they had seen on 24. So I knew it was very much a part of the social consciousness, but I never watched it. I'm catching up on it now. Obviously, I've got hundreds of hours of TV to catch up on.
You got a lot of catching up to do, brother.
So I went in, you know, and did my thing and. You know, they offered me the role, which was great. I'm excited. I'm very aware of how the imprint it's left on American society. So, and they don't bring television shows back either. So that's kind of a big deal too.
Yeah. To be honest with you, I stopped watching like TV ever since 24 was.
Oh wow.
Yeah, I was a dire avid fan of the show. Loved it very much. I loved the series and, you know, the whole counterterrorism thing. And everything. I thought Kiefer Sutherland was one hell of an actor, man. Great dude, man. So that's fantastic. We're looking forward to that. So when can we be expecting it?
I'm not sure. The internet says says May, but I don't know. I am one day at a time, one gig at a time. So, you know, I think it may be out in May, but I'm not sure for certain. I think we'll have a better idea once we start shooting.
Oh, okay, that's fantastic. So you're going to be in London for about
6 months.
Oh wow.
Half a year.
Yeah. Aww.
Wait, what's the aw?
Because he's not in the States. He's going to be, you know.
Man, have a good time out there, man. I heard London women love American men.
London town.
She's like, oh. Especially the Nigerian women out there. You come out there with an American accent. I think they go. Oh, but speaking of that, man, are you in, what's the story, man? Relationship, love, marriage?
Oh, no. actually, I'm single.
Oh, ooh. Man.
Oh.
Ladies, you hear that?
He's single.
Yeah, smart man, yo. Take your time, man. I don't know why these, you know, I don't want to say nothing, man, but I don't think, you know, if you're a big celebrity, man, why get married? Why limit yourself?
Humble Prince.
What do you think, man? Let's talk on it, man. This is a show. We talk about everything.
You know,
let's go.
You know what? You know what? I, you know, for the longest time, I've been just like, I put my career first, and just as far as, you know, relationships, it was very much just being in the moment. But I had a relationship not too long ago that, you know, I was kind of really content with, like, so that was my last relationship, and I kind of, you know, I'm now I'm not so opposed to relationships, you know, and there's a lot that can, like, there's a lot that can come from it for an individual. There was a study that came out I heard about, I heard on NPR maybe last year, that said that men are of the two genders the ones less interested or less happy to be in a marriage, but statistically they're the ones who benefit the most from marriage.
Mm.
Because if you're with someone, a partner, a female partner, or a partner in general, a man will make better decisions than they'll do if they're alone. And as a man, I tell you, I'm single, and I made a lot of stupid decisions today. Today, already. Right? Yeah. If I had a good woman by me, I probably would have done 3/4 of the stuff I did today before I got to the studio.
Wow, fantastic, man. You got here on time, but to what you just said to that, honestly, you know, I make a lot of jokes about marriage and relationships and how women are this and that, but having a good woman in your life is important, man. I would not be in this chair today if it wasn't for my wife. I'll be honest with you. I used to just write a lot of stuff on Facebook, you know, talking a lot of crap and everything. And she said, you know what? Why don't you just transcend this into like a radio show? And she called Sahara and said, why don't you give them a radio show? We spoke and that was it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And you know what I always say, man? I'm so glad that I have she's strong. To be married to somebody like me or any Nigerian man, you have to be strong. And one thing I like about her, I won't say I'm afraid of her, but you know what? I'm keeping it 100, man.
You're scared of her.
Yeah, I am.
No, you know what?
I respect her, man. Like,
I understand, and yeah. there's gotta be a little bit of fear.
There's gotta be, man.
It's like with children. It's gotta be a lot of love and a little bit of fear,
man. Because one thing I say, man, if the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom, the fear of your wife is not too far off. I'm serious. Yeah, because you know she keeps me the check, man, but. You know, big shout out to her. And, you know, like sometimes we'd be out and I get start talking. All she has to do is just give me a look. And everybody be like, Olu, what happened?
he got checked. Silently checked.
Right? That's it, man. Big shout out to her, man. So fantastic, man. We're looking forward to the series coming out.
And yeah, man. Yeah. I'm excited. I'm excited.
It's good, man. So let's just backtrack a little bit. After that, Shakira's going to, I know she has a lot of questions for you. I told some people, you know, that you were coming on the show and everything, and one thing they wanted me to ask you was, how did you get into this, and is there any advice you could give to anybody that's up and coming? And it just, you don't have to just be Nigerian. Any up and coming actor, man, you know, because you're a great actor and everything. Nigeria's trying to claim you as one of theirs, which I guess we could claim you, right?
Niger boy, Adepako.
Okay, let me find out, man.
No, that's about all I can say in pigeon. No, it's. I'm honestly a person of two cultures. I mean, I grew up here in the States,
right?
And there are things about me that are very American, and I grew up in a Nigerian household here in the States, so there are things about me that are very Nigerian, mm-hmm. And I love both. I mean, like when people ask me where I'm from, I give this answer every time. I was born in D.C. I grew up in Maryland.
Right.
My whole family's from Nigeria. I live in Bed-Stuy, you know, so that's where I'm from. You know, so that's my culture. That's the sum of what makes me me. You know, I find here in the States, lots of times they try to say, if you're born here, you're just American, and they try to erase everything that came before. But many other places in the world, like you are your lineage. You know, and so I'm retaining. You are your lineage in addition to who you are today. So that being said, I got into acting. I was in and out of schools and institutions and. Programs and trouble and so on. when I say schools and institutions, there were group homes and shelters and all kinds of stuff.
Really?
Yeah.
They left that out of your biography. I was reading up about
you wouldn't have let me up in here if you knew I was armed.
Hey, Chris, chill, Chris. All right.
This is Wale's cousin. This is Wale's fam.
Yeah. That's my little cousin. He's Wale's cousin. I held him as a baby. I came first.
Are you serious?
Yeah,
yeah, my little cousin. Oh, wow. We grew up in Maryland.
Yeah. No, I knew you guys were cousins, but I didn't know you held them.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
It was wild. He's a talented cat. You know, I'm very happy for what's going on.
Oh yeah.
So I was in and out of, you know, problems and so on, and then finally I started. I was allowed to go. I was in a school for troubled youth, special ed, and so on, And I was allowed to, I mainstreamed out for a couple of periods, got kicked back in, mainstreamed out for a couple of periods. And because I was in a regular school for a couple of periods, I was allowed to finally do an after school activity for the first time. Mm-hmm. And it was wrestling season, so I went out for the wrestling team. And that was my junior year, and I got recruited. Sorry, I thought I turned this off.
No, it's all right, man. That's cool.
I got recruited Division I the next year, and that's what allowed me to go to college. And I ended up going to Bucknell University. Shout out to Bucknell University.
Yeah.
In central Pennsylvania, Amish country all day. and I was a double major in English and poli-sci and in wrestling. And then when I graduated, I worked for the federal government for a year. And then I got curious about acting. And so I researched it. I looked it up online. Google had just come into being. And so it's going into chat rooms to talk to people who are actors, to find out what actors did and so on. And then I started going on auditions around the agency where I worked in D.C. And then I was cast I was offered a role at the Shakespeare Theater in D.C. We did all three of the Oedipus plays.
No, oh, nice.
It was at a small role. They were doing Oedipus set in Africa. So it was me, James, Avery Brooks, and Earl Hyman. It was like all these people I'd grown up watching on television. And me, like, with a spear to the right. And I was happy. I resigned with them from the government, and I've been acting since.
Oh, fantastic, man. That's a great story, man. So I guess a lot of people thought maybe you grew up into this.
You gotta love the hustle. I mean, becoming an actor isn't easy, but it's like not. My family was homeless and we didn't have any food, and like my father constantly put my mother in the hospital and beat us and so on. So all of that, it's like being an actor it was easy compared to all that. So I didn't mind like you know going check to check.
I'm sorry, man. That's why I'm so glad we have you here. We're gonna take a break real quick, and when we come back, man, you need to get into that. When I was reading up about you, I didn't see all that in IMDb and Wikipedia and everything. But anyway, we're gonna take a break real quick, and when we come back, we're gonna continue to talk to Gbenga. You're live with the Humble Prince on Sahara FM Radio. We'll be right back. Damn. Let me find out. This dude, man. You saw me? All right. Anyway, we're back. Live with the Humble Prince, Sahara FM Radio, and we're back in the building with Gbenga Akinnagbe. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, and that was an interesting story you were going into, man. Please tell us about that.
I
didn't know you guys. You said you were homeless at some point.
Yeah, we lived in a shelter in D.C. Wow. And then we moved from the shelters into the projects, and we lived in projects all up until I went away to college.
Oh wow! You know,
I was fortunate to fall ass backwards into a Russian scholarship, and that's how I got out. But that's it.
Yeah, anybody who see would think I want to put time in.
I know they do. Yeah. I know they do. And they underestimate me.
Yeah. Tell you the truth. I mean, we've crossed paths several times. And I don't know if you and I spoke, or I don't know how I know this, but you said something that resonated that I will never forget. And I know your relationship, like you mentioned your father, and I know that you had a tough upbringing, but I just remembered something happened for you to say, you know what, I'm going to go into acting no matter what. You know, was that the case? Because I know a lot of people are in your position where they struggle because their parents don't approve of maybe their career. And it's tough being a Nigerian American growing up because the culture is completely different. But sometimes just people hearing your story, they can be inspired.
No, absolutely. I think we're gifted with so much. Honestly, I think the purpose of life is to spend your life finding the gifts inside of you and then getting them out, you know, whatever that is. So getting them out however you can. And you can spend a lifetime doing that. You should spend a lifetime doing that. You would have had a beautiful, blessed life if you could spend your lifetime finding the gifts inside you and bringing them out and sharing them. And some people mistake that for, you know, doing that, it's supposed to be easy. It's not supposed to be easy. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you wouldn't learn anything.
Right.
But you life is a series of lessons, and they're difficult. A lot of them are difficult. But then when you finally learn that lesson, mm-hmm. I mean, this is just in my experience. When you finally learn that lesson, it's just like a flood of beautiful things.
Yeah. Let me ask you something. So would you say acting? Because this is not something you did growing up or anything, but did it become a passion for you or a hobby or what was it?
I dig it, honestly. I dig it. I dig it now. I didn't do it growing up. I dig it now.
And you're good at it.
You're very kind, man. I do it now because I enjoy it and it pays my bills.
That's what's good.
That's you know, what's up, that's it. And it's not the only thing that I could and would do. I mean, there are a number of things that I would probably be happy doing as well. You know, I've gotten into producing, and I'm fortunate that allows me to continue acting. But there are other things that I, you know, would be happy doing, and even if I wasn't an actor.
Yeah, we're going to talk about you being a producer as well, too, because I know your recent success about that. We're going to talk about that, too. But I just wanted to say, and this is one advice I give everybody, you know, follow your dreams, whatever passion you have, just follow it, man. And, you know, like you said, you know, find what that inner gift is and give it to the world. Like, you know, doing talk radio for me is something my mom, and God bless her soul, she passed, but she said, this is something you should be doing because you talk a lot of crap and you love to talk. And I said, you know what? Yeah, you're right. I do love to talk. And, you know, this is something I'm doing. And one thing I like that you said, that, you know, when you found the acting bug, you didn't just want to go out there and act. You actually tried to polish it.
I wanted to learn the craft.
To learn, you know, exactly.
You know, that's I would say my best skill is that I pick up skills well.
Right.
And so I don't think I'm the best this or whatever, but I'm really good at learning things. So I was like, let me work this thing and learn it. I get approached a lot too because people think networking is how you get a career, and it's not because in the end you still have to, if you get the opportunity to audition or be on set or do something, you still have to deliver.
You have to deliver and perform. Yeah.
So
in a very competitive career, it's very competitive, man. There are a lot of actors out there that don't make it, and actresses.
It's interesting, you know. The odds are definitely not in one's favors. I think I'm in an industry where 3-5% of the people work. Wow, you know,
and to be black too.
You know, and these a lot of the roles that you go out, a lot of the roles out there aren't written for me. You know, or people who look like me. That being said, I personally don't believe in competition in this thing. I think like what's meant to be yours will be.
Okay.
You know, and I know I'm in the minority, pun intended, in that point of view. You know, a lot of my friends who are actors, you know, working and not working, they feel it's competitive and it's you know, you have to compete for these things. But I don't think it's about that. You know, but at least it's not for me. That's
a good.
You know, and I think maybe because I didn't grow up doing it, maybe because I have other interests. I don't know, but. You know, acting is one way I express myself artistically. It's one way.
That's good. Talk about your producing, man. I know you wanted to talk about that.
It's been cool. I've been very fortunate. I have a movie I executive produced called Home that I was in, which is a great film. You can check it out at homethefilm.com.
Okay.
Another movie called Newlyweeds. And Newlyweeds, we got into Sundance and we sold it at Sundance and it was out in theaters for a few months and then it just came out two weeks ago on Netflix, iTunes, Amazon, Redbox. So I'm very proud of that film. Spike Lee said it was the best New York film of 2013.
Fantastic.
You know, it's IndieWire said it was one of the best stoner films of all time. Like,
wow, we got to check it out.
You got to check out Newlyweeds. The trailer, hopefully you guys can put the trailer up on your site.
Oh, yeah,
for both Home and Newlyweeds.
Okay.
It's that Chaka King. They're all first, these writer-directors were first-time feature writer-directors and just really artistic, creative guys. John O. Oliver, who did Home, Chaka King, who wrote and directed Newlyweeds. Right. We had a great producing team with that as well. So I could continue to act and help produce that film. Yeah, I had a great team on that one.
Yeah, you know what I noticed too? When people are doing these things for the first time, because they're really hungry, so they want to put out their best.
Yeah,
they're not
man.
Complacent. Like after they've been doing this for years and they just put out rubbish, but you know, this is their first. So they're trying
it's
to
like
really make an impact. Yeah, just like albums.
Yeah,
you look at rap artists, you know, their first albums.
Slump.
Right, and then it just kind of declines. I wanted to ask you, so what was the difference between you acting and you producing?
Acting, you go in, you do your thing for however many days, weeks, or whatever, and then you leave and you're done. When you're producing, you just had a baby and you're not done ever. You know, like we made Newlyweeds like over a year, more than a year ago, and the movie has checked every box as far as success. It's done everything.
Fantastic.
There's still so much to do.
Okay.
Like Shaka, Michael, and Jim and I, we talk we're like in a four-way marriage every day, like emails every day about this that has to happen, this that has to happen, collaborating and corresponding with the distribution company, the filming a new market, and negotiating a new contract for new territory. All it's like it doesn't stop. So I mean, I dig it. Definitely stimulates a certain part of me that I enjoy. So that's one of the major differences. Another is like when you're producing a film, it's the whole. You're looking at it as an artistic endeavor, but also a product and in its entirety. You know, the people you cast in it, the crew you put together, the locations, all those things. And you're thinking, but you have to look at it in three segments: the pre-production, production, and post. And so, all these things are every day on your mind. And when you're an actor, it's you're thinking about the person you're acting with across from you and the story. You know, that's it.
Fantastic. You were recently in Nigeria. What were you doing out there?
I was in Nigeria. In fact, I was brought out by AFRIF, which is I had a great time, mm-hmm. film festival out there. In fact, the chairwoman of AFRIF, I believe she's here in New York right now, Chioma Uday. She did her thing with that one. She did her thing. Nice. It's like the third AFRIF festival in the past 4 years. And mm-hmm. it's an African International film festival. And mm-hmm. and so they brought me out as a guest, and it was really cool. It mm-hmm. was really cool. Calabar was beautiful. It was my first time there. Prior to that, all my experiences of Nigeria have been Lagos, and Lagos is like New York times four. Yeah.
You know, and you think so?
Oh yeah, and I like that, actually. I love the hustle, you know, but it was nice to see a different aspect of Nigeria. I'm like, mm-hmm. oh wow, it's nice, it's big, it's clean, fantastic. It's green, it's safe. It was really cool.
Yeah, actually, yeah, that's one of the things we're going to talk to in our roundtable. I just wanted to get your perspective of, you know, what your trip to Nigeria was like. Because the other guy, too, he just came back from Nigeria as well. I was just there myself, too, so I know we could contribute to that. So let's take a break real quick, and when we come back, we're just going to round up this segment. I think our next guest is here, but just one or two more questions we're going to ask you, man.
No problem.
And thanks for being so humble and down to earth, man. Amazing, man.
No, thanks for having me, man.
Yeah. Thank you, man. We'll be right back. Live with the Humble Prince. Sahara FM Radio. Yeah, we're back. Live with the Humble Prince on Sahara FM Radio. Shakira's in the house, and of course we have Gbenga Akinnagbe with us. Thank you very much, man. It's been a very nice interview thus far, man. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Real quick, can we give a big shout out to DJ Ishmael, Fine Boy on the 1 and 2s. Thank you so much.
Fine Boy.
Yeah, Fine Boy, man. Ishmael, thank you so much for holding us down, man. So I just want to say, like, you know, I was saying during the break, man, everybody knows you're critically acclaimed on The Wire. I mean, Chris Parklow, man, that was a very interesting character that you played, man. Let's just touch on it a little bit. What's that experience like, and working with it? What's that guy's name that all the ladies what's his name again? He was in some movie. Is that his name?
Is that his name?
Yes. Yeah, I don't know what women see in that guy that they don't see in me. Yeah. Man. I'm serious, man.
It just was cool. I mean, honestly, we had that cast. Like, it was a dream cast, and we didn't know it at the time. And then, what's great is that we're all still tight. We're Wire family. Like, it didn't end for us in 2008, you know, because it's still...
It was around for six seasons, right?
Five seasons. But it's still such a part of the social consciousness internationally. Like, right. So it never ended for us.
It made such an impact, man. I mean, I think that was even kicking The Sopranos' ass for a while, because
Sopranos was a great show. Sopranos
started, like, what, in 98, I think. 90-something, like that. But you guys just came in and right away, everybody could just relate.
There was a drop in drug activity as far as selling and buying for an hour Sunday nights. I'm not exaggerating. Like there was a recorded drop like every Sunday.
Wow.
So not only were like the lawyers and doctors and teachers, everyone watched this, but the drug dealers would come off the streets.
Yeah.
Off the streets to watch the show.
Could you be because you guys were living their life? Or,
oh, absolutely. Or I mean, I'm stopped all the time by people who were out there living in the life and who felt that they were grateful because they felt there was an honest depiction of what they did and what they were going through, and not just the drug dealing, but them as humans. Yeah, humanized what was the name of
the producer of the show again?
It was the creators of the show, David Simon and Ed Burns.
I almost said David Chase. Sorry,
David Simon. Right. Yeah, they had the three Davids over at HBO. David Chase, who did The Sopranos.
Right.
David Simon, The Wire, and David Milch, Deadwood. Deadwood. I'm rewatching that now. That's such a brilliant show. Dialogue was amazing.
Yeah, but yeah, man, The Wire. You know, it's became a main part of the society.
Yeah,
you know, it's critically acclaimed and everything, man. So great show, man. So I'm glad you guys
thank you, man. I was fortunate. I was background extra in the pilot episode. I was background, like you just walking back and forth across the street. You don't even see
really?
Me. Yeah. And so a couple seasons afterwards, I became reoccurring. Then a season after that, I was one of the leads. It was an amazing experience for me. Still is.
Yeah, how did you break into that character though? Because you,
I seem different.
Yeah, you do. No, that's me, right?
Like I said, I grew up differently than I seem now.
Wow, yeah, fantastic. So yeah, guys, if you haven't seen The Wire, man, get the DVD set, man. It's definitely a groundbreaking show, man.
Please do. I need those residuals.
But HBO owns that though, right?
The show, yeah.
Yeah, but so how would you make money? I mean, how would you?
Oh,
make
they residual? Own it, but like because of my union, SAG, we get a certain percentage of residuals.
Oh,
you know, like their foreign sales and like it was the same with movies. Like when a movie plays, like Pelham's, someone was watching Pelham the other day.
Yeah, I saw a clip of that because you were in there with Denzel.
Yeah. And so I get a little bit of change from that, but very, very, let me emphasize little. It's true. And then if it plays in a different market and different markets around the world, that's if it's on television, if it's on DVD, those are all different.
Yeah, guys. So platforms. You're listening. Go out and support our own child. Support him. Yeah, definitely. Let's move forward, man. What's some of the things you're working on, man? I know your beautiful clothing line. We were right side by side at the Nigerian Independence Radio.
Yeah, that's right.
Selling those t-shirts.
I'm right now most excited and most proud of liberated people.
Okay.
If you're listening, this is live, right?
Yeah. Oh, this is live, man.
If you're out there listening, go to weareliberated.com.
Right.
Tweet us at We Are Liberated.
Right.
and Instagram us and so on. And check out the apparel line. We honor the liberation dates of nations around the world.
Absolutely,
because that's one of many things we have in common as brothers and sisters in this global family. And I believe very, very firmly in this idea of global citizenry.
Nice.
So I traveled around the world, and I've been in one protest or another. I was recently on trial in Brooklyn. Protesting stop and frisk. I was arrested about 2 years ago, and then for about a year and a half, they were giving us these plea deals that we would turn down every time, so we could have the trial, stand trial, and some of our group were
it was a lot of you
were,
guys,
yeah, and some of our group, including Cornell West, were convicted in Manhattan. Some were convicted in Queens. I was part of the Brooklyn contingency, and we were acquitted. So all of these things, I've been to the West Bank in Israel a couple of times, to do what I can there, and all of these things kind of led me to form Liberated People, to emphasize and shine a light on this I don't want to say brotherhood, this family, this family that we are. I think if migrant workers here in the States realize that their struggle is similar and respected by people fighting the lifting of fuel subsidies in Nigeria or wherever. If these people who are struggling for their different causes realize that some of their causes are alike and have been, these people have been fighting for generations. Like we're stronger that way. We just are. So liberated people encourages people to travel if you can, even if it's down the block to a neighborhood you've never been to, and just like get connected to other people. And you can check out some of the work we're doing on weareliberated.com.
Okay.
I just gave it.
Fantastic.
I was invited to give a TED talk in October. I did that representing the company, and it was on Stop and Frisk.
Oh, wow.
Right. And invited to speak at the UN as well. And
wow.
That
You're
which
a busy
was amazing.
Man.
Amazing.
On behalf of the company, we on a panel of factivists.
Right.
Bono's organization won. It was an honor for them to invite me to be one of the factivists. And we spoke about the global Millennium Development Goals. representing the company. So definitely, Liberated People, I think, we say we're honoring our past by claiming our future.
Wow.
So that's what the company is about.
He's not only an actor, producer.
Factivist.
Now, also, you see how humble he is. He's doing stuff to help the community. Like, that's
fantastic,
amazing.
Man. That's amazing. Yeah, you get a amazing. Round of applause
amazing.
That,
I'm trying to get rich.
Pay me. You're doing big things, man. So any other things we should look forward to? Sorry. So the We Are Liberated. You guys have the t-shirts.
WeareLiberated.com. Right now I'm wearing the Ethiopia shirts.
Yeah, Jonathan, can we get that on camera real quick?
Right now I'm wearing the Ethiopia shirts, standing with my Ethiopian brothers and sisters.
Yes.
We have India. We have Brazil. Especially with the World Cup and the Olympics coming up.
Yeah.
We have the Nation State shirts. Of course, we have the Niger shirts.
Of course, man. Also, the Nigerian Independence Day shirts, man. That was fantastic, man.
Yeah, man. So, yeah. And we use water-based printing. So, it's quality. It sits in the shirt. It's very smooth. This is not on the shirt.
Oh, okay.
They're pre-washed, pre-shrunk. So, it's a quality product.
Yeah.
Let
them see the t-shirt, man. We Are Liberated. Yeah,
date right there. Let me show you the date.
Oh, okay.
Oh,
nice.
That's what's up, man. So you're doing big things, man. Again, Factivist. We got 24 coming up. I was on IMDb. I saw a lot of things in red. Post-production. So what's that about, man?
Projects. I have a movie coming out. Yeah. I did a movie called Big Words, which was great. Neil Drumming, who wrote and directed, is a friend of mine. It's his first film, and got into Slam Dance. It was picked up by a firm, Ava DuVernay, her company, and it was out in theaters. Now it's on Netflix. There's a movie I did called Fort Bliss, I'm very excited about. So that should be, that's making the festival circuit now. So yeah, just been plugging away, yeah.
That's fantastic, man. Yeah, that's good, man. So again, thank you for joining us. I know you're going to join us for the roundtable a little later.
Yes, fantastic. Depending on the time.
No. We're gonna wrap things up again. Please, let's give this guy a round of applause. We wish you
to you guys
continued success and everything. Thank you so much.
Keep watching.
And, definitely, man. Keep supporting, man. I'm looking forward to 24, man. I'm definitely gonna plug
if you're out there, tweet Fox and let them know that you're supporting the show and tweet. Tweet me and this,
let them have your Twitter handle. We Are Liberated.
I have two, and you need. I would love for people to follow both. We Are Liberated,
right?
And at Gbenga Akinnagbe.
Okay.
Uh-huh. And the same with the Instagram. We Are Liberated and at Gbenga Akinnagbe.
Okay, fantastic. Yeah, guys. So there you have it, Gbenga. Thank you so much for joining us,
man.
We'll be in touch. Wish you continued success and everything. And
thanks
for being so humble and coming down. You're so down to earth, man.
No.
And one advice I got to you, man: stay single for a minute, man. Trust me. You don't need to get married any time, man. Make that money. Women love they love men with money. Anyway, we'll take a break right now. When we come back, we're gonna talk to Kenneth Aura. He's just gonna tell us about his new movie coming out about loving. So it's a movie about trafficking. Sorry, human trafficking. It's called Love and Traffic, and we'll be right back. Live with the Humble Prince, Sahara FM Radio. All right.
Cool.
And we're back. Live with the Humble Prince, Sahara FM Radio. And now we're going into the critically acclaimed Humble Prince Roundtable, and of course we have friend to the house and no stranger, of course, Mr. Ernest Carter.
Danjuma, you can just call me.
Let's call you Danjuma, man. I have another Ernest in my phone. That's who I probably sent the outline to, man.
Unprepared.
I'm really, really sorry, man.
We'll do it. It's all right.
Fresh back from Nigeria, man. Welcome back, man.
Absolutely. Thank you very much.
So you guys, had like a little sojourn, man. So did you go around Africa or just you were just in Nigeria?
I went to a couple of countries. I went to Morocco.
Nice.
I went to Liberia,
okay.
And then I passed through Ghana, and then I went to Nigeria.
Yeah, how was that, man?
They were all very interesting. I remember most, what was most striking was traveling around with a Nigerian passport. Oh, my God.
You better get that blue passport, man.
Oh, my God. It was definitely. The worst experience you could ever have.
Yeah, we're definitely going to talk about that. Gbenga's handling some business right now. He's going to join us later. But let's get into this roundtable, man. Of course, absolutely. I don't know if you saw the little joke by Basket Mouth.
Correct.
Yeah, let me just give the people a little synopsis of what the joke is about. So people are calling it a rape joke, but this is what comedian Basket Mouth, who's also known as Bright Okpacha, this is what he said. He said, okay, so the full context of the joke reads as this. White girls, first date, coffee. Second date, kiss. Third date, sex. African girls, first date, fast food. Second date, hug. Third date, Chinese restaurant. Fourth date, kiss. Fifth date, attempted sex but failed. Sixth date, shopping. Seventh date, cinema, new phone, and more shopping. Eighth date, attempted sex but failed. Ninth date, rape.
Oh boy.
Yeah, and of course, the joke was not received well by a lot of his fans. Yeah, that's what he said. It was a joke. You know, guys, if you're out there, please, we'd like to hear from you. The number to call is 917-646-559-6640. First of all, what's your take on the joke?
The thing is, as with a lot of things, I think what really happens is, as men, because I sort of dismissed one, a similar incident to this, you know, a little while ago. I don't know, you remember when Rick Ross, you know, had a song, with the whole model, you know, and, you know, it was, you know, he insinuated that he date raped, you know, he was, you know, he was saying it was, you know, it wasn't really a big deal. And as men, we've sort of, we're not as sensitive or as, you know, to the issue of rape as we should be. And I think that that's really the where this is coming from. It's even if you see a lot of the explanations or the apologies that turn really into explanation of, you know, trying to justify what you're saying, you know, they're just some things, some topics. I mean, you can make jokes without, you know, without sort of, you know, picking on. I know for a lot of men will say, you know, oh, it's not really a big deal. What, you know, he's not really saying anything. But as women, what I read something, you know, that women constantly have to, you know, live with the fear or the paranoia of
being raped,
the possibility of rape. And so there's nothing to joke about. They have to always be on their guard as to, okay, this, it might happen today or it might happen, you know, tomorrow. And so, you know, I would advise, you know, anybody that, you know, that thinks it's not a big deal to do a little more research. And, you know, you might find, you know, that it's a little more sensitive than you might think.
Yeah, I'll tell you what. A lot of women also didn't find the joke, didn't see a big deal with the joke. I'll be honest with you.
Correct. Right. Yeah, and there's always going to be that small, you know, minority of women who say, you know, well, you know, I didn't, you know, I'm a woman. I didn't find it. Yeah, let the women do that.
Exactly.
As men, let them do that. Don't. There are black people who don't find, you know, derogatory terms derogatory.
Exactly.
But that doesn't mean you should use derogatory terms. Leave it to them. Leave it to those people who don't find it annoying.
What did you just say?
We hate nothing.
No. Yeah, Gbenga, thanks for joining us, man. I know you had to handle some business.
Sorry about that, guys.
No, that's fine, man. What we were talking about was, like I said, the rape joke by comedian Basket Mouth in Nigeria. And I'll just go through it again real quick. And what he said was, white girls, first date, coffee, second date, kiss, third date, sex. And then he said, African girls, first date, fast food, second date, hug, third date, Chinese restaurant, fourth date, kiss, fifth date, attempted sex but failed, sixth date, shopping, seventh date, cinema, new phone, more shopping, eighth date, attempted sex but failed, ninth date, rape.
Who's raping who in that situation?
Oh, well, the guy's raping the girl.
Oh.
Yeah, he was doing a comparison between white girls.
I think what he's sort of trying to say is, you know, he's playing on the, like, I guess this, I don't know if it's a stereotype in, you know, black culture that, or popular culture that, you know, black girls, you know, play, well, African girls play a little harder to get. You gotta, you know, you know, take them out on dates, and you gotta, you know, do all these things to the point where
I think it's more the stereotype is more not necessarily they play hard to get more out of the dude is the stereotype.
Correct.
You know, so it's not as like holding on to being virtuous. It's more the stereotype that is that they're just being more strategic and manipulative. Correct. I'm not saying I agree with that. Love my African queens.
Definitely. You know, yeah, but, most beautiful women in the world, man.
You know, but the joke in and of itself, I think Basketball is funny. That joke didn't seem funny to me. So it's not because it was actually not even because it was rape, it just didn't seem like a funny punchline. Me, I will laugh at anything. I don't as far as moral, this, that, whatever, I make all types of like jokes that have, you know, people would question the moral standing of it left and right. But you've got to be funny. I think artists have to have some leeway to find the line to cross, you know.
Right. Honestly, once you inject rape into anything, man, it becomes it's hard to, especially think about girls that have been raped in this situation.
Yeah, I was listening to
condition is not good.
I listened to NPR earlier today. One in three women have been beaten or raped. You know, in the world, that's 1 billion women. You know, 1 billion, which is. Yeah. Staggering. Right. And many of them are unreported, which means huge numbers of women we know.
Right.
You know.
Yeah, rape. So I mean, think about it. I mean, here, if a woman is raped, mm-hmm. and she comes forward and there's evidence that she's been raped, mm-hmm. I mean, the chances that the culprit is going to get, you know, prosecuted, is going to go through the jury system, the judicial system, and everything. Now think about Nigeria, in Nigeria, though, honestly, there are a lot of girls. There are probably
a lot of due process, and there's stigmatization.
Exactly. Thinking that it's okay. There's probably a lot of girls that's been raped, you know, whatever age, but are just scared to come forward. Let's think about it because they figure, you know, if they come forward, there's nothing is going to be done. I mean, you think of a country where, you know, that's Nigeria is considered lawless, mm-hmm. and everything. So that's why I thought the joke was a little bit insensitive.
In his defense, not that he needs one.
Yeah.
A lot of the time when these things happen, the chants are, let him lose his job, let him.
Right.
You know what I mean? I don't know that I necessarily subscribe to that.
Right.
I do think that it's, he needs to understand, though, because from what I've heard of his apology, it wasn't really.
What was his apology?
It's sort of trying to explain that he really wasn't saying this and that. Yeah. They don't really understand the severity of what it is.
Yeah, let me say that. Let me read his apology. He said, Basketball pointed out that he had a daughter, a wife, and a mother, insisted that he would never in his 1,000 lifetimes promote rape. I broadcasted a joke that many clearly misunderstood and have found offensive, and I sincerely apologize. The intention, however, was to highlight the unfortunate trend and the ridiculously flawed comparison between money and the worth of a woman.
That's what I'm saying. When you try to, which is what sort of what Rick Ross did in his own explanation, you know, you try to bring in, it's like somebody, you know, say a white person, he's like, oh, my, I have a half brother who's black, or I have a. Nobody cares about that. That's not the issue at hand. Right. We all have mothers, we all have sisters, we all have daughters, we all respect. Even rapists respect some women.
You think he shouldn't have told the joke?
Yeah, the joke was unnecessary, but that's happened already. Mm-hmm. In your apology, there's no need to justify what you were trying to say, because that suggests that you didn't understand why people are taking offense to your joke.
Can anyone? So that begs the question: is rape a subject that is beyond jokes?
Beyond jokes.
I would say so. In my opinion, yeah. I think. You know, rape is
by men, it is.
Because if
even
I
by
if,
women,
if I, by men,
because if I look at you and your pretty face, I would tell you to stay out of prison. You know, and see how you both laugh. Yeah, so
I have a pretty case face.
Point. You see that?
I have a pretty face.
There's
that,
a joke.
That is it.
There's a
that,
joke. About,
that's the joke.
But that's the first joke. But there's the joke right there about raping you in prison, and you both laugh. So is it beyond rape, or is it the content? I mean, is it beyond
it's,
rape?
It's about,
it beyond,
it's about
you didn't say the, you didn't say the word rape.
Which is what I said.
You suggested it.
Yeah, which I think is a more clever way of making a joke about that. You know, but is it? But you both laugh, so it's not necessarily beyond joking.
So you know, so
is it context?
It's the context. Context. I mean, maybe it
you
is know context.
What? You made a good point.
It is context.
And is it the context and based on gender? Because I laugh because
it's,
you know
it, because it's a joke. It's a man. I mean, it's a man thing. It's not as sensitive.
Exactly.
As, it's not as sensitive as
we're gonna have you picking up soaps or however they call it. You know, stuff like that. You know, so. Yeah, I guess because it was towards women, I guess that's why I found it a little sensitive. But, you know, thanks for calling me out there and making me laugh.
Yeah, I'm just saying.
And saying rape is beyond jokes. No, but, just, but you know, it,
I think rape, it is, because rape of men is not as,
Hold
prevalent.
On now.
It's not, a prevalent, it's not as prevalent as society.
So in the military, there's like in the U.S. military, there's a huge number of rapes that happen every year, every day.
As there is in the Catholic Church.
The majority of
There is a like, well, all right.
That, and the majority of the people raped in the U.S. military are men.
By?
Correct. By men. Other men.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah.
Interesting statistic,
that?
Man.
Exactly. A lot of people don't realize that.
I didn't realize that.
Yeah, so
I knew the rape happened, but I didn't know what the statistics were.
Yeah, we mentioned my apparel line, Liberated People.
Yeah.
And on the Tumblr, one of the most popular things that we've posted that was retweeted is this series of powerful pictures of these women who were all raped, and they were holding up pictures, like little cards of what was said to them when they were being raped. Like
wow.
like 2-3 sentences of what was said to them, the variation, the amount of the staggering, the depths of what was said. Some of it was jokes, some of it was blaming them, some of it was things you would never even imagine, and that was said to them. And then the same group that did this did one for men. And we put that out as well.
Wow.
Liberated People put that out
we
as well.
We need to get that footage,
man. And that was just like, again, devastating. It's like all these men who had been raped and the things that were said to them and the ages that they were raped in, and some of them were adults, some of them were kids, and holding up signs with the like basically the last few words that their rapist said to them as they were being raped.
Wow.
You know, it's amazing.
That's
amazing.
A big moment to me, man. So just so before we go to the next topic, man, what's your final say on the whole basketball joke thing, man? What do you think?
Like I said, I think it's a matter of men when making jokes about, but like anything, when you make jokes about topics that are sensitive to a certain group, you should stay clear of them. There's so many. He's the funniest. He's one of the funniest people I've ever met.
He's funny dude. Yeah, I noticed that. Yeah, we tried it. Like
I said, you don't need to kind of go. And if you think of a joke, and you pause, you should probably reconsider. Yeah.
Big shout out to Bright, man.
Can women joke about rape?
Yeah, they can do. They can do. That doesn't have anything to do with us because that's within the group.
He sounds like he makes it different.
I don't know, man. Because to those that have been raped, does not fit. I don't think they'll find it funny.
They'll take it up. They'll take it up with the women.
Yeah, so it's among themselves. So it's like amongst Black people.
Exactly.
N word. Yeah.
Exactly.
Final words on the thing, Gbenga. What do you want to say, man?
Because
you seem rape jokes. What's your take on?
He's like rape jokes.
Yeah.
Go. What do you think? Yeah. Got some? What's going on?
No, not on this show, brother.
No.
Okay.
I have a hard time coming up with a list of things that are beyond satire.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we just as human beings we need to be able to create satire on anything. It's how we cope as human beings with stress, with degradation, with all types of things. Yeah, much of Black humor is based on horrific things that have happened to Black people. You know, things that should be outlawed and should not be repeated and so on. That being said, you obviously should know your audience. You obviously, I mean, like this epidemic of violence against women is just mind blowing to me.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just, and it's not okay. Yeah, you know, because these are our sisters. I mean, and
our mothers.
So trying to figure this out, and honestly, I'm of the mind that the perpetrators are victims as well. Like they when a woman is raped, it damages us all. You know, when a woman is beaten, it damages us all.
Yeah.
So I think once we start to address it that way, it'll hopefully it starts to the numbers start to shrink. But if we're just in a system of just like you know, punishment without trying to understand, or punishment without trying to solve the problem. Because punishment doesn't solve the problem. It treats a symptom, but it doesn't solve a problem, whatever right. the problem is. So you have to look at it holistically. It's the same with our education system, how we try to fix that, homelessness and so on. Right. No, we have to see why these people are homeless. We have to see why these schools are broken. We have to see why men rape, you know, and address it that way. You know, wow. So it's not the joke. I mean, if he's gonna make a offensive joke, but for God's sakes, at least be funny. I'm not against offensive jokes. I'm not saying I was for this joke, but like, just blanketly saying no offensive jokes. You know, it's that as an artist, I think people have a right to say offensive things. You know, right. So
yeah. Oh wow, so, interesting, man. And I think rape is such a hideous act, and if you could keep it out of jokes or comedy altogether, you know.
It won't stop it from happening. I'm more interested in stopping it from happening.
True, definitely, man. Definitely
feel that as well.
Yes, but so talking about mistreatment of women, let's use that to segue into our next topic. Ernest, I really apologize, man. I thought I sent him the outline. I sent it to another Ernest. To my other homeboy, Ernest, man, why don't you reply me and say, what is this about? You just accepted it, man. So I got to change the name of my contacts to Dan Jimmer. But I wanted to talk about jungle justice in Nigeria and this recent video that surfaced that happened sometime last year. And it was shown before a panel in Nigeria. And this was about a woman. You know about the jungle justice where, you know, they think you stole something. And even if you're guilty of stealing something, they just, you know, beat you around right there, put a tie on your neck, douse you with petrol or whatever and everything. But this one was hideous. This lady was accused of stealing
pepper
mm-hmm. right? And the acts these men carried out on these women, I can't even find the words to say how disgusted I am. And I pray that, you know, no punishment is too severe for these bastards. I mean, they sodomize. The video's out there on YouTube, guys.
I'm texting my web guy. I want him to put that video out. The one that you showed me where it shows the people watching it and their reaction.
Yeah.
People need to see what other people do to other people. And that's the only way we stop this stuff. We need to personalize it. We need to see our brothers and sisters up there.
And I'm glad you're doing that, because I got some flack for putting that on my Facebook page. And I said, because people was saying, oh no.
It's hard. It's very hard
to
watch.
I had to put it, I put it out there to create awareness, because it's ugly. Even if this woman stole $1 million, she shouldn't have been treated like that. I mean, they actually took a bottle and sodomized her. Yes, they beat the shit.
They beat the shit out of this woman. First, they blinded her with pepper. I mean, yes. She can't see. She's naked. They stripped her clothes.
And this lady was begging, pleading, please, at jaw. She said she didn't steal it. She didn't say it. But these men proceeded, and the bastard that was filming it and all of them, I pray, like they say in Nigeria, Shalanga Lemakusi, that means you'll die in a cesspool, man. I mean, I hope they rot in hell. But, you know,
That right there is mob mentality. And to be perfectly honest, you get any group of people subject to mob mentality. You can get everyone in this office.
Remember that happened in Harlem here. Yeah. Remember the guy, the motorcyclist?
About the difference.
You know,
yeah,
you
go
can
ahead.
Get, you can get everyone in this office to go out and commit a horrible crime to someone in the street, given the right circumstances. It's mob mentality. You can stimulate certain things in a human being, especially if it's okay, perceived or subconsciously to be okay with the group. You know, then a whole bunch, and it's uncomfortable, but it's true what we're capable of. That is in no way justification.
It's not.
So my point to that, the reason I say that is because it has nothing to do with what this woman stole or didn't say. I know that these men think they did because they're saying this and saying this, but something switched in these guys, you know, that made this okay, and it's obviously not okay, and they need to be held accountable.
Right. Do you think we need to address a bigger problem because Nigeria is just lawless and there's no.
I'm sorry. Nigeria is not lawless. The law. Laws are for sale. I can go and buy one now. You can find laws. They're just for sale. You know. So if that woman came from the right family and if she was in the right area, like she would have justice.
But there was no system.
The United States.
There's no system to say, okay, this lady stole pepper. Why don't you just go report it and let the.
No, that's not true either. There is a system. These people went outside the system. There is a system, even in these villages. There's you have to think about it. These villages have been around. These villages and towns have been around for hundreds upon hundreds of years, and they have a system long that's older than the United States as far as their systems of laws and justice and accountability. These gentlemen, these monsters went outside that system. We can't just say because they're in a village they're lawless or Nigeria's lawless. No, things happen and the system's corrupted. People go outside the system, but these villages do have a system of accountability that. They're not being held. These people aren't being held to. Now that being said, because of the attention that's coming onto them, hopefully that somebody will hold these people accountable. But that's a problem. The people the cops are easily bribed. That doesn't mean there is a system,
but it's just not being enforced.
It's circumvented. You have to now whenever we point fingers to Nigeria, I think it's important to make sure that we find that if those things exist here in this country, this first world country. It's true. We have our former president killed millions, and there's a lot of people who made billions off of that,
right,
off of fraudulent wars.
Talking
he's
about
not
that.
In prison.
A former president? Yeah. Our current president is killing millions of people.
Let's not go off tangent.
That happens in Nigeria. That happens here in the United States. We have illegally killed more people than as a country than Nigerians have of Nigerians. We have. So where's our system of accountability? Because these people have Ivy League degrees and they're nice suits and we have paved roads. It's different. They change the laws as they go, so it's not illegal. No, this is immoral. This is illegal. So people are going around the system. They're just powerful enough to do that. I can't change the law, so it doesn't look. So when I do it, it's a crime. Like Bush can change the law, so it's not a crime when he does it.
I will say this though. Yeah. Whenever there's Nigerians are indicted of something, they always our first instinct is to find. An equivalence, in America or in a civilized world.
Yeah, you see?
But the fact of the matter is,
right,
there is a system of accountability
here
in what I would call the civilized world that is, that is fundamentally missing there. There's a decay of I guess.
Why do you think that is?
The moral decay. I'm going to speak to the why in a little bit, but the mob mentality,
right,
really is because it's so prevalent in Nigeria. I can't say that it's a one off or it's fueled by the attitude that we can't if we do it all together, we're not gonna, we don't have to be accountable or whatnot. It's not because they don't perpetrate that to, when there's a politician that, that steals money.
Exactly.
Or that goes before, a committee. There's they afford those people, certain.
That is true all over the world. People of certain classes and wealth get away with things they shouldn't get away with.
But mob mentality, tires on people where there's police. We're not talking about a village where there's no law enforcement.
So what do you think the problem is? Is it the people or the system?
I think it's the people.
Wow, I think it's the system.
No, I just said there was no system.
I didn't say there was no system. I said people circumvent the system.
And
because honestly, if you put us in that same system and generationally, we would do what they do. For example, it's like blaming black people for high crime. I had a debate on Geraldo a couple months ago, and we were debating the sheriff Clark from Milwaukee. He was saying that stop and frisk was a good tactic, and that these people were morally corrupt and this that whatever. Mm. And this was a black man, and the right wing loves him. And I'm like, how can you judge these people? How can you judge these people like this and then also police them? You can't do that. The crime levels are high in Appalachia, where it's all white, but it's been poor since forever. It's about class, it's about poverty, and so on. You're going to have the same behaviors no matter who the people are. So you put us in that system. I like to think, we can think that we're beyond it. I promise you, we're not. When given uncertain circumstances, living day to day in the village, working like our whole lives, and having seen our parents work our whole lives, and so on, and then something just snaps and goes. Not that village life is bad, but given certain circumstances, and then the crowd, it's cheering you on, and this is okay. what we are that happens here in the States, not to equivalize
not,
it, but
not,
any,
not to that
it's
extent.
Not the people. I'm
going to specifically
in Texas.
Wait, let me finish and then you go.
In Texas, they remember a while ago they dragged this black. It was years ago. They dragged this black man to pieces.
Yeah, right? Those guys were drunk. Right, exactly. They tied him to the back of a car, his ankles.
In Kings Plaza and here in Brooklyn. They had like about 400 or 500 kids.
Kids, recently, right?
Yes. The mob, that's the definition of mob mentality. Do you know what they were doing there? They're just walking around, knocking people out. 400 or 500 kids, you can't get 400 or 500 kids to do anything. You could get them to do that because it was okay in that situation. Something clicks when you see like a group of people like, this is now the norm. And this is scientific. What is now the norm changes, and once that happens, their behavior changes.
Right, but let me say something, though. I think the main difference is, with all this, anybody could wild out, do whatever. There's accountability, and they will find you, and they will arrest you, and put you through due process, and you will go to jail. Those guys that beat that lady, if this was in the United States,
I know. Not yet. When did it happen?
It happened last year, February. You mean to tell me nobody can identify those people?
And you're right.
I've seen it happen multiple times.
You're right. As far as accountability, like our system of accountability, although
there's zero,
although it's deeply flawed in the U.S., it's more reliable than in Nigeria, and because it's just a much, both systems are corrupt. Nigeria is much more blatantly corrupt. But you also have to go back to, so Nigeria was set up, we all know it was a colonized country and so on. It was set up by white aristocrats and royals to rule over and dominate the black populace. They leave. The black populace come into power and continue the same system that is built to destroy black people. So you're having black people destroy black people. I'm a student of history. This system that was inherited and then taken over, it was not meant for black people to survive or thrive under. So we wonder why Nigeria is the way it is. It's because we're doing the same things that the colonizers did. We're doing the same things. It's amazing.
That's a very interesting discourse, man. We'll have to save that, man.
But man, I'm definitely not justifying these crimes and how horrific this. Right. It was disgusting what these people did, and what's even. What's almost as disgusting is that they haven't been held accountable. They're not arrested.
I mean, they said it took place in Ejibu, in Lagos.
That it was in Lagos.
It wasn't Lagos.
These are not villages.
That's another thing. You're right.
This
that's a major
in the city.
There was a girl that beat in the market because she stole a BlackBerry, put into the BlackBerry up. You know, come on, man.
This happened to my friend in Abuja when we're talking about they were at a light. All you have to do is scream, and everybody kind of has. That's why I say it's the people. It's not a system. There's an inherent. I know that if I scream thief, everybody's gonna come, and their instinct is gonna be, oh, let's kill somebody.
But let me ask you this. We see black people here in the States often when it comes to crime. Is it because they're black that they're predisposed to crime?
No.
He's hesitating.
I'm saying wherever this happens, it's not a systemic failure. It's a people failure. If this happens like it did in Washington Heights on the highway where, you know, some guy ran over people and I guess he ran off.
Yeah, the motorcycle mob got him. Right.
And they came after him. That's the people. Motorcyclists going in groups have a gang mentality, and that's
and those
the
people
blame
have been held
them.
Responsible
for
everything.
For that.
But we're gonna take a break with somebody. Let me give you the final word. I'll give you guys pertaining to jungle justice, right? How do you think we can try to curb it or just get rid of it completely?
It has to be. It's funny you say the people, because to me, I think the solution, the problems are with the people. The problems are systemic, but the people are the ones who can solve it. The system we allow it to be, right? So if I can blame the system, but in the end, we're the one who's given power to the system. So we're the ones who can change it. So like it was Kennedy who said that the problems of man are man-made, so they can be solved by men as well. So as far as jungle justice, we have to create a situation, create a world where these things are not socially acceptable, like violence to women, not
it's
socially
not acceptable. Period. Man.
That's my point. Like we're social creatures. Once the laws of society like are set, because they are changeable. They are changeable. Like we fall into place. And so when things change in a moment with amongst the people where the laws of society like now say this is okay to commit this murder, to commit this rape because it's now he's this person who was just a citizen before is now a thief and everyone's recognized them. And these are the things that are okay to do to thieves. Like then anything can happen. But again, when we make it so that it's not socially acceptable to do this to thieves, when we make it socially acceptable, acceptable to do these things to women under any circumstances. Right. The numbers will go down.
Sorry, Gbenga, excuse me. Let me just take this call. You're live with the Humble Prince. What's your name? Where are you calling from? Make it quick.
Hi, this is Maxine calling from Philadelphia.
Hey, Maxine from Philadelphia. Oh, look at that voice. Wow.
Hi.
Cools me down. It's
how
cold.
How are you doing?
Good.
Thank you.
How are you, Maxine?
Yeah. How you doing, Maxine?
I'm well.
Danjuma is saying hello to you, and Gbenga is saying hello to you. Say hello right back.
Benjamin, hi. Gbenga, hi from a fellow Bucknellian. So.
Hey, what's up, man?
Oh, okay. Make your point.
Okay, fine, whatever. Research. Don't hate. Okay.
Thank you for listening. Go ahead.
You guys were talking about jungle justice. And,
yeah.
CCP, I saw the post that you had on Facebook.
Right.
And it totally sickened me to the core.
Definitely,
man. It's crazy.
Yeah.
I think, yes, it's a societal problem. I would go that route. I think that the fact that people are able to do such things and get away with it, I think that makes it continue, right? Mm-hmm. So you figure, like, you're driving on the street here in the U.S. or whatever, and you're going 100 miles an hour. The consequence of that action is that you're going to get a ticket, you know? Right. You go to a place in Nigeria and many other countries as well, and you do that, you could easily get away with something like that. And I think until we're able to look at the society and the issues that we do have and say, listen, this is not acceptable, and you're going to be punished, regardless of this village or the city or wherever it is, you know, that these people are really punished with, like, sense of law, I think some of this is going to continue, right?
Right.
It's amazing, not to go away from this topic, but, like, about a year or two ago, I was visiting Nigeria, and I heard that, like, the king of a small village died, and they had to find, like, 7 people to bury with him, you know?
What?
So just things like that. Yeah, it's ridiculous. It's crazy.
I have to Google that.
Are you serious? Like, we got to research everything.
I have to research that. Wow.
Yeah, crazy, you know?
That's and this is happening in the 21st century.
So I think until we really have help people, hold people accountable for their actions, I don't think, you know, no matter how much, you know, I think we just need to, like, be able to, like, penalize these people for what.
Thank you, man. I think we need to instill
accountability.
Accountability.
Yeah, right. Exactly. That's what it boils down to. So,
Maxine. Maxine, wow. Beautiful voice and smart. Thank
Don't
you so
much. Don't sexualize my sister now. Hey, peace. Respect that one now. Respect.
Yeah. Maxine,
why would I call you? Never say that about my voice.
Pause, brother. Okay. Yeah. Maxine, thank you so much for calling. Thanks for listening, man. We really appreciate you.
No problem.
Thank you, Maxine.
Bye. All right. Well, Maxine has spoken. Let's take we're going to take a break real quick. When we come back, we're going to round up. I want to hear about you guys' trip to Nigeria real quick. But I just wanted to ask you guys one question before we get into that. So we're going to take a break. Live with the Humble Prince, Saharatv FM Radio, and we'll be right back.
Can't wait.